Hey y'all, this is T. Graham Brown. Thanks for tuning in to this episode of the ETX Rock Show featuring my friend Ricky Lynn Gregg. Don't miss it.
This is Boston Chris with another great episode of the ETX Rock Show.
Louise here.
D-Script.
Featuring all genres and styles of entertainment.
And mommy just call me ETX Rock.
Let's hear it from Louise, please.
From the unheralded and unheard to the legends and beyond.
Out of the box with ETX Rock.
It's awesome.
We keep them coming.
$5, that's pocket.
Well, hey, y'all, this is Haley McDaniel. Are y'all ready for this?
ETX Rock Show is the greatest show of all time, okay?
We are ETX Rocks.
The ETX Rock Show is the best show of all time, say? The other shows, you're good, you're real good. But as long as we're around, you'll be second best, say?
Cut!
From the great state of Texas, this is the latest episode of the ETX Rock Show. Nestled in the piney woods of East Texas, the ETX Rock Show delivers the stories and songs of talented artists of all genres. All styles, from the unheralded and unheard to the legends and beyond. We bring a passion for music and a drive to go behind the curtain with our guests. We focus on all artists, from LA to New York, Nashville down to Texas, and everywhere in between. ETX is our location, not a limitation. As always, it's viewers and listeners like you out there that are our biggest support for the show. If you want to contribute to the show, please do so by donating to www.paypal.me/ETX Rocks. And thank you for tuning in. Thanks for checking out this 204th episode of the ETX Rock Show. Now, in this episode, one of my favorite people on the planet is returning to the show for the second time. He grew up right here in Longview, Texas, and honed his skills early on under the wings of Uncle Dallas. He learned his craft in long-defunct venues all across East Texas in blues and rock and roll, but he is most well-known internationally as one of the first country artists of Native American descent to be signed to a major label. With 3 albums and 10 charting singles, he could also be considered the first of many video stars on CMT, having charted several videos in their top 10 throughout his career. He was also reportedly the first country artist to have his own website. But lately, however, my friend and brother has been battling health issues that have chiefly happened because of a hard-on-your-body lifestyle that many musicians deal with throughout their lives. Ricky Lynn Gregg, the 2017 Guitarist of the Year for the ETX Music Awards, is no stranger to working hard and playing harder. In this in-depth, no-questions-barred interview, we ask Ricky the hard-hitting questions about his lifestyle, his health, his outlook, and why he is speaking up against drugs and alcohol. Don't miss this introspective look into a legend. So we have Ricky Lynn Gregg back on the show, second time. Unbelievable stuff again, Ricky, in my living room. As you guys know, if you tuned into the first time we did an episode with Ricky, I think it was episode 129.
Wow, good memory.
I think it was 129. And this is going to be 205, so we're in season 3 now. We're smack dab in the middle of our celebratory week. You guys, we brought you some pretty good content this week with Katie Lynn, Ronnie Millsap, Josh Ward, Blacktop Mojo, and now we're sitting here with the legendary Ricky Lynn Gregg. And this is going to be a little bit of a different thing for me, because usually we're all about focusing on the positive.
Yeah.
And Ricky's been going through a lot of negative things in his life with health issues and stuff that were chiefly brought on by you being a rock and roll star, basically.
You know, remember that old contract they said when you write it to the devil, it says sex, drugs, and rock and roll?
Yeah.
And not necessarily to him, but yes, when you start in this business, you have a lot of things come at you that you mistakenly, falsely, without instructions, fall into.
Right. And we did talk a little bit about the fact in the first episode that music was really your only go-to. You didn't have a backup plan. It was this or who knows what.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, when you're that wrapped up in what is the only thing you know, I mean, how do you say no? You know what I mean?
Yeah. And you're 15.
Right.
I think that's why I want to speak out, because, you know, I'm seeing a lot of more younger guys, 13, you know, mm-hmm. like Reese.
Yeah.
He's 13, he's got a band, he's got a going at it, and I know at 15 things were thrown at me that I accepted just so I could be accepted within that crowd. And you know, alcohol is the first thing.
And for you, was it chiefly alcohol?
It started out as didn't like beer, liked alcohol.
Yeah.
15.
So the hard stuff.
Hard stuff.
Yeah.
Southern comfort. And then, you know, as I moved along through high school and people drank, I'm not going to say my friends, but we
people
all drank.
People who you thought were your friends.
We all drank.
Right.
And we just were more grown, we thought. And, you know, by the time I got to Fort Worth at 19, and I was full-fledged, hey, I can drink the best.
Yeah.
And probably could.
Right. And, I mean, we did talk in the open about a little bit about Ricky, and I mean, a lot of folks out there know Ricky as a country music superstar from the 90s, but Ricky is not about the country music, I promise you. I mean, I know you as that guy with a guitar that's just blowing the roof off every venue I've ever seen you in. Trust me, the reason why he won Guitarist of the Year is because he's the guitarist of, like, the century. Very underrated as a guitar player, I think, throughout your career. But, you know, in the clubs and bars here in East Texas, you got your start in rock and roll, in yes. blues, in yes. soul, all yes. of that grooving, heavy music,
yes.
You know, brought up by Uncle Dallas and all the other guys yes. in the scene. A lot of folks out there may not know that about you.
Well, one of the good things about starting at 15 in a town, Longview, Texas, that is an oil boom area back in 1973, the town was doing quite well.
Yeah.
And
especially the music scene.
The music scene. A lot more bars than there were bands.
Right.
That's when I came involved. A guy named Marcus Sossland and Kevin Russell came to the... Marcus came to the YMCA. I'm playing basketball. I'm 15 years old.
Imagine that, a YMCA in Longview.
YMCA, yeah. And I'm playing basketball, and he's going, "Where's Ricky Gregg?" And I said, "Right here." He goes, "You know where I live." Of course, he lived in Ware Acres.
Mm-hmm.
I said, "Sure." I said, "Come to my house when you're done." Walked out like a New York lawyer. And, you know, all my buddies were going, "What'd you do?" And I go, "I'm through playing basketball. I know that."
Yeah.
And basically followed him as he drove home, which was, he lived right across the street. And I was in a rock and roll band. Kevin and Marcus, I mean, they had their own agendas. I can't blame anything on them. It's the fans that begin to adore them.
Right.
And sometimes...
So, I mean, we talked about vanity a little bit off camera.
Yeah.
I mean, that has a major role in...
Major.
You know, people are starting to know who you are, and you've got the long hair and the good looks, and you're jamming up there on stage, just doing what you love.
Yeah.
And then you start to realize that, holy cow, people are putting me on a pedestal.
Yeah.
And then maybe somewhere along the way, you start to make yourself believe that you deserve that.
Absolutely.
You know? Did you feel a whole lot of pressure? Because I know you started as a teenager. Did you feel a lot of pressure right away from not just peers within the industry, but like you said, the fan base?
Yes.
That, hey, we need, you know, I'm here now. I need to do what they're doing. I need to keep up and do all of that.
Well, as you know, this area really, they demand a lot out of a player. You know, they don't want to fool with the cheap stuff, and I say cheap stuff, excuse me, that for lack of better words, they want to see good players.
Right.
And this area is full.
Absolutely.
Of great players.
Always has been.
And for me, I felt like buying a Flying V. I felt like throwing it by my head and playing absolutely horribly.
Right.
Okay? But the fact that it was behind my head and I'm on my knees, I was great.
Yeah, it's all about that visible.
Right, and living in your boots and your same jeans and you know, changing your shirts and looking rock and roll 24/7. I mean,
coming out with a chainsaw.
Chainsaw.
That wasn't you, but...
you know, well, I was in that band, 18 years old. You know, here comes Uncle Dallas, says, I'm about to be Uncle Dallas.
Yep.
And I want you and the best bass player in the area, and unfortunately he's not with us anymore. His name was Randy Phelps. Oh my gosh, what a title loss. Him and Terry Sawyer, one of the greatest drummers around.
Wow, what a heck of a band.
And of course we did his...
Who plays drums in that band?
Terry did.
Really?
Yeah, Terry was a monster.
He
just came out of playing...
Uncle Dallas let somebody else play drums in the band.
Oh my gosh, and they brought him in a casket.
Wow, yeah.
They set him down.
I've heard those stories.
He popped out and opened up a real chainsaw.
Right.
And that's how you run people off, is that fumes from the motor of a real chainsaw.
Yeah.
And
see, Uncle Dallas is a good example, too, because I know later on in his life, he had given up the alcohol and the drugs and all of that stuff. You know, and it took its toll on him as well.
Yeah.
So he's a good example of, you know, here's why you should quit, because I know he had a good few years being clean and sober and all that, and he was a heck of a guy.
You know, he...
Did you have anybody when you were young trying to keep you away from those pitfalls?
Probably the one that was most serious that I didn't take so serious because he's, you know, was up my butt about something my whole life, and that was my little brother Dennis.
Mm.
And, you know, families are families.
Right.
But he worked at Schlitz Brewery in this beautiful town. You've turned into Stroh's. Now it's Chernobyl.
Right.
You know what I'm talking about, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
And he says, you know, I work at a brewery. I don't drink, you know, but it's not the same.
Right.
It's not the same. We in Nashville sit around T. Graham, cats like that, and go, you know, what is, you know, because his big number one was wine and water.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he made a big leap. Gave it all up.
And he was, I mean, he would be the first to admit that he was one of the chief drinkers in Nashville.
Oh, no doubt.
And, I mean, what a great song. We had T. Graham on the show as our season 2 finale.
Yeah.
We're here in season 3 now, and he actually let us play that song on the episode. And we talked really, we talked in depth about that song and the effect that it's having on people worldwide. Not just addiction to alcohol, but
to this day.
Yeah, it's having an effect on people that might want to commit suicide or having trouble with any kind of addiction, really. So, you know, and I know that was a huge thing in Nashville in the 80s. So, I mean, you're a young guy and you're in Texas still. Yeah. Kind of creating and cultivating that lifestyle, whether it's toxic or not. You probably don't know either way.
You don't know.
Because, I mean, you're young, so you think you're bulletproof, you know, and then you realize 30 years later that you're not so bulletproof. But then all of a sudden, you're signed to a label in country music of all things, and now you're in Nashville. I imagine you probably have a little bit of money in the bank at this point. So now you've got that addiction lifestyle and some money to feed it. So how did things go in this transition?
Toxic.
Yeah.
Because at 15 drinking and dabbling.
Right.
See, our when we went to school, you know, the blurb around town was, go look in your mom's purse.
Mm-hmm.
What will you find in your mom's purse? Well, if it looks like this, it's that. If it looks like this, it's that. Now go to your dad's vanity
medicine cabinet
and look for that. And we kind of become pill hits.
Mm-hmm.
And speed or whatever, and the speed.
Right.
Before I left Longview, there was something even harder. And I'll just tell you what we called it. We called it Nazi crank.
Okay.
And Nazi crank was something that the Vietnam vets came back
And
made barrels to keep awake, to keep alive.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, a lot of bars and a bunch of that.
Right.
And so by 23, there was no more of that. Mm-hmm. Because they were making it out of, I don't know what.
Yeah.
And a lot of people that are watching this program now know that, well, yeah, that stuff's made out of Drano or whatever. Back then, I don't know what it was made out of.
Yeah.
But I know that it rotted everything out. I had to have surgery to fix my nose. I had to have surgery to fix my throat. At 23.
Do you get to the point as a musician who's under the lights a lot, especially a well-known musician at this point, do you get to the point where you feel like you need it? Do you feel like you're almost arguing with yourself, like, well, it's okay because you can, you know, a doctor can prescribe that, or, well, I need this to get up because if I don't, then I'm not going to be able to put on the show the best that I can. Is that a conversation you went through?
But it takes probably 3 decades.
Right.
To realize, you know, that, okay, I've been playing sports, I hurt my knee, I got a bottle full of pills. Wow, mm-hmm. They're opiates. They make me feel great. Well, guess what? 2 make me feel better.
Yep.
Now I'm doing a gig, and man, I'm down.
Right.
3. And the alcohol.
Right.
that happened to me in the early 90s. But I got to tell you about the late 80s when I was with Head East. Cocaine was hard and heavy and coming at us. I didn't like it. I did it out of peer pressure when I did it.
Mm-hmm.
And probably did a lot of it, if people want to know, too much. But it's hard on your heart.
Right.
And drinking is what you do to go back to sleep.
Right.
So I quit Head East, literally, along with John Schlitt. I took John Schlitt's place, along with Steve Houston, the original drummer in Head East, because they didn't want any more of that lifestyle.
Right.
I also quit, because I said, I'm going to Nashville. And I've been networking a little bit through Tony Harrell, who's from this area.
Yep.
So, been on a couple of my records, and I said, I can do this, and this is a clean town. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
This is a clean town. This is 1986, and I get there by 91, and I'm staying, I'm networking, I got a publishing deal. And
are you clean at this point?
I'm clean at this point. I'm still a drinker.
Right.
But drinking's not bad.
Right. Well, that's what you convince yourself about.
I've quit the hard stuff at 23. I've gone through this cocaine explosion. I've made the decision and went to the doctors. I've got a strong will. I don't really have an addictive personality. I have a binging personality.
Yeah, right. What's the difference?
The difference is I like sports. I like good food. I like to be healthy. I like to be competitive. You know, Longview had a great city league basketball thing going there for a while. Racquetball was big. And then all of a sudden you get really looking good and you go, boom, oh, how you been, old pal? Mm. Hey, you want a little of this? Like, sure. And then you're off to the races for about 2 weeks.
Okay.
And you're being really, you're killing yourself.
So it's like, as long as it's not in your face and you don't have to have it, but
right.
Once it's available, it's you know what, I'll do this for a while.
Yeah, and you walk in and you don't really ask for something. That's addicted to.
Right.
You're just, I'm an abuser.
Yeah.
And I abuse because everybody's abusing.
Right.
And this was the 90s. And now when I get my country deal, things had to be serious. A year and a half after signing with Capitol Liberty, I broke this finger. As crooked as it looks.
Yeah.
2 weeks later, I'm in St. Paul, Minnesota, playing the Taste of Minnesota. And they said, you don't have to play the show. It's raining. And I go, no. I've missed one show for surgery. I said, we're playing. And get on the drum riser and slip and break my ankle.
Wow.
I mean, in two. And, you know, I finished my show. I don't, you know, that was probably coming from hard knocks and being a little rougher and tougher. But they sent me to the emergency room. It was empty. They took x-rays. He goes, well, you got an orthopedic for that. Give him this. You know, you've busted your foot. And he goes, tink, shh. And I said, guess what? We're doing the second show. Right?
Yeah.
And
you're Superman
the
now.
Show must go on, you know? I mean, they got stuff for this. And right then and there started the opioid era of my life. And I'm not going to say names, but, you know, I had someone that was a confidant, that, you know, blood close to me that we... you know, we took aspirin and ibuprofen to do the show, but when we saw his autograph lines, it's like, oh Lord, this is gonna hurt.
Yeah.
And then that's when we would take the opioids, and I'm talking about Lortabs and hydrocodones, things you can't get nowadays. And
right.
Somewhere between the way I have it now and the way it was is where it needs to be. That's another story.
When did you realize you had a problem?
Okay, I did real good. Slow down on drinking. I'm not pilling because I'm not breaking anything.
Mm-hmm.
And it's beginning to be 2000. And I had some choices to make. Do I go for another record? Yes. It's when T. Graham talked to me and said, now you need to talk to George Carr. He's over at Interscope. And I go, that's a rap rock
record
company.
Right.
He says, yeah, but there's a country division, and that's how I got my number one. I'm going, he got you that number one,
mm-hmm.
So you can do that. Because they'll, you know, money's the key.
Right.
And they pushed your song along, and I was so happy for him, my God, you know, because he, you know.
Yep.
I mean, who couldn't love that guy, yeah. Right?
Great guy.
I think I got a beard right now because of him. You know? I'll never cut it.
He was completely clean shaven.
Was he really?
Yeah, he sure what was.
Man, for a while there, he was looking
woolly. Yeah, you went. You went with the beard. He went without. He went without. I was without, like, dude, yeah, something's going on here. They're like right. Trading places or something.
I think that the opioid problem got bad when I signed a record contract and a contract with a company out of Las Vegas to do opening acts for the agency that I was with.
Okay.
And George Jones was on this agency. Confederate Railroad, I can name others, you know, some other older
right.
country people, but we had shows, we had 5,000, we had 10,000 people shows, we could sell CDs, we could sell t-shirts. That's how you make your money.
Right.
And I got into the casino business.
Oh, Lord.
And you know, what's sad is there are mannerisms that come with pills.
Mm-hmm.
And this is horrible, but I learned these body language. And I would slide in next to a lady, a nice lady. She's got grandkids, and I'd go, you know, my leg really hurts tonight. She goes, how bad? You know, it's like, well, hold on. I'm going to the bathroom and come right. back, you know, ka-tink, ka-tink.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you got two of something, pal. That can't get me off stage. Of course, you're adding alcohol with it. And it got to the point to where the devil was running at me.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, I couldn't go anywhere without somebody.
Yeah, it was always there.
Oh, I mean, just come up going, hey, man, you...
The temptation's like, always, right. Yeah.
From the most innocent people in the world. To right. the point where they were giving me their whole prescriptions because they had them elevated
right.
in numbers.
Right.
So I got to where I was opioid pretty much a lot.
Yeah, and then, of course, you know, you have those folks that, you know, well, I'll buy you a shot.
Yes.
You know, and I mean, I've been a karaoke host and that happens to me, you know what I mean? I can imagine what's happening to Ricky Lynn Gregg on that level, man. You know.
And, you know, you learn a lot about pills, and this is my life. A lot of people stayed on powders and devil dust and whatever. It didn't go with singing. I was real proud of the voice. It took a long time for me to get it to where it is.
Right.
Honestly.
And you've always been known for your voice.
I know.
Which is crazy to me because I've seen him play guitar.
That's what I wanted to be, was a guitarist.
Right.
And I could sing higher than a bird whistle.
Right.
And I could be a great background vocalist. But each band that I got into, which wasn't a ton, they were very good bands, but I would end up being an intricate part of the lead singing.
Right.
For a reason or another.
Yeah.
And so here I am, a singer, love guitar. But the casino life introduced me to good people that had things that I would acquire and turn them into bad things. And I'm talking about two's good for you, then four must be great. Mm.
Just a warped sense of advice, basically.
It's medicating yourself, yeah. Some people call it.
Right.
I call it dumbassity, if there is such a word.
There is now.
There is now. It's just something that you do, and then one day you run out of pills.
Right.
And then you don't have that drink before the show. It's like, has anybody got a bottle?
Right.
You know, and you're kind of freaking out. And that's when you begin to know, I have crossed another line. Or if you look at it as a racetrack, I've made that turn.
Right.
And then you make another turn. And then you make the last turn, and it's too late.
Yeah.
And now... What I want your audience to know is...
Before why. You get into that, yeah. We'll get into the why here in a minute. I do want to take a brief break. We're talking with the legendary Ricky Lynn Gregg here on the ETX Rock Show. You're tuned into episode number 205. Definitely want to thank you guys for following along. Hey, we have a quick message for you guys, and we're going to talk more with Ricky right after this.
Thank you for tuning in to the ETX Rock Show.
All right, guys. So we are back with the legendary Ricky Lynn Gregg. We're talking about addiction mostly in this episode and what you guys can do out there if you're in that boat. You know, peer pressure is a prevalent part of the music industry. It has always been and always will be. And that's something Ricky has dealt with his entire life. I'm going to ask him a question, though, that I've never asked you. I know you are Ricky Gregg.
Yes.
Okay, but somehow or another, the middle name ended up part of the stage name. So who made that decision?
Right. Who would ever... Lynn, my God. You know, when people said Lynn around, I was like, you just call me by my female name, man. You know, but there are a lot of Ricky Lynns out there. But for me, you know, when I left Longview as Ricky Gregg.
Right.
I getting savvy, and there's a Ricky, and a Ricky, and a Ricky, and a Ricky.
Wow.
And there's four Rickies, and so we have a meeting. And I'd never been in bands at that point that had really meetings.
Right.
I had a leader in the band, and he told us what to do, and you know, I was a good follower. Well, we had meetings, and we got four Rickies. What do you want to be? And he goes, I'm Rick. And he was the owner of the club. And, okay, well, you've got second seniority. Who are you? And he goes, I'm Rich. And you? And he says, I'm Richard. Who ended up being RJ Jones, a fantastic bassist. Was dwelled around here, U.S. Lords with Donnie Pendleton.
Oh, yeah.
We worked together in Savvy early on, and he was Richard before he became RJ. So I'm thinking...
Ricky Lynn.
Ricky Lynn. And, of course, the band, you know, they had nicknames for me like Tex and... Junior.
I've been called Because
I'm from
before.
East Tech.
Yeah, I've been called Tex before when I go back home.
When you go back home.
Call me Boston here in Tex and Massachusetts.
Right, Tex and Massachusetts. Yeah.
Talk about a confusing lifestyle.
You know, it stuck. And I just became Ricky Lynn. And you know, then you start doing things right. You start getting your publishing companies. And, you know, I had a Ricky Gregg, then I had a Ricky Lynn. And Ricky Lynn became synonymous. You know, I could turn a corner, somebody go, Ricky Lynn, and yep. They were talking to me.
It sure has, and RLG is, you know, the initials has become a thing where you say RLG, and most people know who you're talking about. You don't have to be from East Texas to know that. But again, we're talking with Ricky about a really punishing lifestyle that he's had for most of his life. It started when he was just a youngster in his middle teenage years, you know, getting raised in rock and roll, honestly. That's where Ricky came from. Raised in the pool halls and the clubs and all up and down East Texas. And just given into peer pressure. But you've never really been an addicting personality. You've called it more of a binging personality. I know that for you, alcohol has always been the biggest battle.
It has been my killer.
Yeah.
And, you know, despite the amount of, we'll call them drugs, mm-hmm. I have ingested a dozen amount to the alcohol.
Right.
And alcohol became something that was a fun state to be at. And what'd you drink, Ricky? Well, I drank tequila, or I drank Jägermeister, or I drank, boy, that's some really blasted stuff. Well, that's why I'm doing it, mm-hmm. not for the taste.
Right.
You know, I'm doing it for the effect.
Yeah.
And so was everyone around me. And of course, you've got anything from 150 to 1,000 people doing it with you in nightclubs. You know, we had big rock bars back
right.
in the early 80s that held 1,000 people easy. The Agora held 1,700, and it'd fill up every time we played it, you know.
Well, I mean, here, you know, lately, and when I say here lately, I mean within the last 4 years or so, you're really trying to get back into your music locally, you know, playing a lot of local shows. Of course, you know, Ricky still does a lot of casino stuff in Mississippi and a lot of other different states, but, you know, you've really been focusing a lot more on local stuff. And you're still battling with the alcoholism and stuff like that up until recently. And I would say, you know, this might be the hardest question I've ever had to ask you or anybody on this show, so give me time here.
All right. I still love you.
The reputation kind of comes with you as a drunk, as somebody who's not professional and all of that. Yeah. So how does Ricky Lynn Gregg change that? How do you change people's viewpoints of you that have had to deal with you when you're under the influence?
You don't.
Right.
What you do is, and I'm 58 years old, and when I grew this, it's because I grew up.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't plan to cut it anytime soon. Somebody may cut it off while I sleep. But this is kind of my, okay, I was, you know, like your dad said when you're a kid, what are you going to do when you grow up, son? You go, well, I'm going to play guitar. And he goes, well, you can't do both. Mm. And
meaning you can't grow up and make a living playing guitar. Yeah.
God was good to me, and it was a good ride, and I never let Jesus out of my sight, even in my darkest hours. I think that was the start of healing, but it was only a seed that was barely watered.
The question is, did it take your health issues for you to realize that I need to stop this? Yeah. I am literally killing myself.
Yeah. And when it became a problem is at a divorce. You know, I drank. People would laugh about it. They go, you drink it? I go, only at work. Okay? You know, at home, I don't drink at all. Mm-hmm. I didn't really have a problem.
So everybody else that has the problem, right?
Right. So when you're younger, you can metabolize better. Mm-hmm. When you're Native American, you've lost that enzyme to chew up alcohol, quite like the Irish.
Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's a true thing there. I had to go to Europe to find that out. But over here, it's like, Indians, now they're all drunks and stuff. Well, there's a reason. And on Jeopardy, the next question is, we've answered that one. But it doesn't become.
I love you, brother. That was great. Let's go on the blooper reel right
there. Yeah.
All right, so like I was saying before, Ricky, you know, you do carry that reputation with you, and you're still trying to get booked. I know the doctors probably say don't work as much as you used to, but you have that passion within you to work. Yeah. But you're also carrying that reputation around.
Yes.
So how do you get work? How do you get over that hurdle?
You don't. You don't with your musician friends. There's only one remedy, and that's clean up. Pull yourself up by your bootstraps, so to speak, for lack of better words there, and go out and do good and shine and make a good paycheck and pay your guys who've given up on you 100 times because of it really has to do with personality. Some people can drink a lot, and they can ingest a lot of whatever other ingredient they might use. And they're fine.
Right.
You really don't know it. They're not a problem.
Well, it seems to me at this point that you as an artist and as a man have two choices. You can either hear what people are saying and prove them right, or you can hear what they're saying and prove them wrong.
Yeah.
And I think that's the biggest thing that you're facing right now. As long as you go out and prove all of those people wrong,
right,
then the reputation gets better.
It's kind of like it's not what you did, it's what you're doing.
Right.
And we're in this quick burn America now, you know, where, you know, used to, you know, singles would stay on the radio for 10 weeks sometimes, you know, number one.
Right.
Now it's in, it's out, it's in, it's
instant
out.
Instant gratification.
It's boy,
everybody needs it and then throws it away.
That's it. And, you know, I've had other friends like Steve Earle, and, you know, I don't know if you know his story, but. And John Cow and I, which I didn't know, which was with the Bluegrass Revival.
Mm-hmm.
Monster singer sings with Doobie Brothers now as a bassist. Mm-hmm. Man, these guys, they had to go through some fire. And you do lose confidence with good players. Because when I would go out on the edge of the gangplank of fun, I would... throw guitars through ceilings at the end of the show.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, one's not enough.
Mm-hmm.
Let's throw two.
Yep.
And, you know, they come out and one's broken in half and it's a $1,500 guitar. It's like, no big deal. Because, like you said, it's the money.
Mm-hmm.
And your opinion really don't, you know, I'm screwed up. And tomorrow I'll have a big ass headache. And guess what? I don't care what you think. When you get to the point where I got, as you said, the doctors. And I want your audience to know that I don't have blockage, I don't have valve damage, I don't have, I haven't had a stroke or a heart attack. I have ventricular tachycardia. That means the rhythm of my heart, this goes this fast on the top chamber, and this fast wants to do this, so it's out of sync.
Mm-hmm.
What caused that? I asked my doctor. I said, just this last time when I went, I said, I've got to know. I said, we became close, you know. I said, the drugs and alcohol caused this. He said, no. He said, 42 years of it. He says, and you come from a family that's, you know, we know this now.
Right.
We knew it 10 years ago, but we preach it now. Back then, we just mentioned it. What's your history in your family? Mm-hmm. Well, we had heart disease in my family, and I just, being a free spirit.
Well, not just that, man, but, you know, I've known you a couple of years now, and, you know, there's no off switch on you, man.
No.
There just isn't.
There's entertainment, you know, and yeah. I love to entertain. And the thing was, is alcohol got... it got to be okay. That's how I'm getting revved up.
How you maintain,
man,
that.
I'm gonna tell you what, I had to have that. I would quit drinking.
Right.
But I had to have that first double.
Mm.
And by the end of the night, I'd have that second.
Yeah.
That's as slim as it got.
Right.
But I had a blast.
So when's the last time you had a drink?
Yeah, absolutely. Last time I had a drink was December 24th, 2016.
That's right.
2016.
So almost a year.
Yes. Now,
you've been completely clean in all that time?
From alcohol. I did resort to something else. Now, why, Ricky, after you've been diagnosed with this congestive heart failure, would you go do something? Well, when you get older, as we were talking about being younger, you can metabolize as well.
Mm-hmm.
You've probably been wrestling with it for 5 or 10 years.
Yeah.
But I couldn't sing. Remember me telling you, I said, Boston, I can't
sing. So that's why you did it?
So I stopped drinking because one ounce of alcohol, the doctor explained to me a year ago, would take this amount of time to get out of my body. But he began to tell me that as soon as it hit my esophagus,
right,
it turned into a toxin.
But since that time, you've done something else.
Yes.
So why?
That's the deal. When you're younger, you can get over your problems a lot quicker. You're a little more handsome. Your confidence is up there no matter what. God created band. Guitars made us equal.
Mm-hmm.
Things. And then, you know, you realize you do develop a heart. And it's called a heart and soul. But a damaged heart comes when you throw a substance. And so I had a little incident last December. Which kind of, I got my heart in a tough, tight situation. I got broken. You ever had one of those?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
They're kind of weird. You know, it takes more super glue to put them back together. And at that point, I was in circumference of people that we all respect, and we began to binge on drugs.
But that was the last time?
Yes.
So 2017, nothing.
2017, up until July. Let's just throw it out there.
So you're clean since July?
Clean since July.
Is that it for you?
Yes. And
now, there was a pause there.
The pause...
I told you I wasn't going to be easy on you.
I know. And I appreciate that. And I appreciate it for your audience and my audience. I have to be clean or I'll die.
Okay.
One more drink and I'm dead.
Okay.
As we're going on right now.
Now, I've told you several times that I will whip your ass if I catch you.
You came in.
So not only will you die, but you'll have to deal with that too.
You came in.
I'm a lot younger than you.
Yeah, absolutely, and strong.
I might be able to take you, Ricky.
Oh, trust me, I'll lay down like a subservient dog. Is like, okay, got me. But you've came in and looked at me after hearing things and just said, "Look, I got 5 minutes I could spend, but come here. What are you doing? You know what to do, right?" And it was people like yourself, you, Boston Chris, that compelled me to stay the course, stay on the highway. Don't get off on that rocky road,
mm-hmm,
that trail. That's how I'd lose my way. And, things begin to happen well after I quit drinking. But it's like, hey, I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't pop pills. No marijuana. Hey, let's try lighting this sparkler. and smoking on it.
Right.
Now, you people are trying to figure out what a sparkler is, but I'm sure you know that there's a lot of things you can smoke out there that aren't good for you. I just got into it, and it took me to a place that I could not be healed until I fell out, which was in August.
Okay.
Because had I not fallen out, I may have done it again. What am I saying? I'm quite sure I would have.
Right.
And then they come in and they said, well, when we diagnosed you with the ventricular tachycardia, you had 30% of the heart, which freaked me out.
Mm-hmm.
Well, then when I had to spare, I didn't care. And then when I was woke up and I had a trach down my, you know.
We're talking September here now.
Yeah.
And guys, you know, Ricky has a lot of fans out there, a lot of friends, a lot of folks that he considers family. I'm blessed to be one of those. But we almost lost Ricky in September. A lot of people out there may not know how close it was. Ricky won't tell you that. I have no fear in telling you guys out there that we almost lost Ricky Lynn Gregg in September. And that's why I'm that guy that's always going to keep it real with Ricky. I'm not going to tell you what you want to hear. And I know you have a lot of people in your life that are that way. I grew up as a huge Elvis fan, for example, and I feel in my heart that Elvis is no longer here because he didn't have that person in his life telling him, knock it off.
Yeah.
And so that's the role I've taken it upon myself in your life to make sure that you have somebody in your, you know, wilderness of voices that's keeping it real.
And to stay consistent.
Absolutely.
You know, it's one thing telling someone once. You almost despise them the next time you see them after they should have come to your aid.
Right.
You've come every time.
Absolutely.
And it's really kept me on the path.
Now, you know, we went and visited with Ricky in the hospital in September because it was a surprise to him. It was not a surprise to anybody else, but Ricky won the 2017 award for Guitarist of the Year at the ETX Music Awards. And so we brought that award to him at the hospital in September. Completely shocked him to death, almost, I think. What role did the award, and knowing that your fans voted you in for that, how does that change your outlook on life as an addict? Because for me, if I'm in that position, I'm like, man, they love what I'm doing. I need to get my crap together.
Yeah. You see this big smile on my face.
Mm-hmm.
When I knew I couldn't sing, and that would have been in 16, that would have been somewhere around June. I said, I can't carry a show. So I began to hire other singers to play and sing, help me sing. And then by August, I can't sing anymore, and I'm canceling dates.
Mm-hmm.
And Jackie and I try to go to Memphis and try to make a go at playing the blues bars instead of the casinos. I couldn't sing. We come back to Texas for a brief while, so she could ail over a torn ACL. When we went back, I was basically worthless. I'd had so much heart damage just from not taking the medicine,
right.
You know, because when I got out of the hospital in December 16, I took as much as I could, and I went to go get my Xarelto filled, and it was $416. Well, I've got insurance. Well, now that you're good, because if you didn't have it, it's $710.
Wow.
So it's like, wow, okay, well.
So you get into that catch-22 where you need to work to pay for your medicine.
Yeah.
But you can't work because
of
your
health. Yeah.
And again, we come back to, you know, this was it for you. There was no backup plan.
No backup plan. And I began to, of course, I reside in halls with Sammy Brazier, and we really got into guitar.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I began to have a few students, and having a couple of students just for little money, you know, I don't really care about the money.
Mm-hmm.
I just enjoyed, I found a few youngsters, 14, that just, they could pick it up so fast, and it was so fun. Because
mm-hmm.
One of my things with Sam was, you know, at Music 101 was, I don't want beginners. Don't make me sit there and teach an E chord for 3 months. You know, yeah. I want to show them songs.
You wouldn't want me
then. Right. I want to show a kid the fundamentals first. Right. You know, they'd be so bored. And I'd show them scales, and all of a sudden now they're playing scales for their friends, and they're going, wow, this is music. Now we're writing songs. We barely know how to play.
That's awesome.
So I'm being inspired. So that inspired me to go home, literally, to our little clique we had going down to the Oil Well Club. And we played somewhere else, up at Sandbar, maybe.
Probably.
And
it was a Sandbar. I remember
and,
that.
You know, it just became a blast. And now at the Oil Well Club, I'm up there with Sammy Brazier, Donnie Hiles, who's a bassist, but he's a great guitar player, yeah. You know. Ron Holcomb.
This is the church. I call him the Church of East Texas Music.
Ron Holcomb, which was like one of my heroes when I was 14, yeah. You know.
Ridiculous.
He was ridiculous. Great voice. He was playing, and I was playing.
And Terry Salyer, I think, was
and
there.
And Terry Salyer would get off the, right.
Yeah.
He would get off the drums and play guitar, and other guitars would come in and play.
Yeah.
Everybody
plays everything.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I just was able to stand back. First time in my life. Even at 15, you have to understand, David Roach was our lead singer in a band called Exit at Papa TJ's on Highway 8. He was accidentally killed. And I'm the lead singer. Remember me telling him about this? Why are you a singer? And he's like, well, it's taken me all these years to be one.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a situation where we're going to keep it going for him. But I was inspired by these kids. I was inspired by the way my other guitar brethren played. And it was inspiring to play different.
Yeah.
I wanted to be, okay, I'm playing with you tonight. I want to be different. Oh, I'm playing with you tonight, so let's get out this guitar.
And I noticed that. You definitely were changing. And I mean, you were, you know, you what's the best way to put it? You were part of the band again.
That was part of the band.
You know?
It was
cool to see that because, you know, just throwing the solo, you'd point over or nod or whatever, just to see you do that. You know,
shit.
It was like, and to see you smile again was really important.
It was a blast, and then they'd go, Ricky, want to sing one? I'd go, no. I've never done that. 42 years of singing and playing, and if something hit the wall. You know.
Sure, you even let me sing.
I did. And you did a great job. We did some Folsom Prison, didn't we?
Yeah, Folsom Prison.
That's
we
right.
did some George Jones.
Some Jones,
yeah,
that's right.
Yeah, we did.
When are we going to have our
I don't know, we could do that. We'll
series.
Do a duo, the Ricky and Boston show. Be like Donnie and Marie, but a little different.
Right. I'll wear the dress this time, okay?
Well, you have longer hair than me right now,
exactly.
So that probably makes the more sense anyway. I don't think you're as pretty as Marie is. So.
Well, right. I don't think she'll ever be ugly.
Well, I agree.
You know, she's going to be pretty.
This is what happens when you get us together, by the way. We just go off these little rabbit holes and stuff like that. I'm going to try to pull Ricky back to the here and now, though. So you've had quite a lot of blessings along the way here.
Yes.
And I think you'd be the first to admit you probably don't deserve most of the blessings you get. I think you do. I think we all deserve our blessings, regardless of where they come from. But when you are within your own skin, you don't feel so deserving of those blessings. One thing, I think the award is a huge blessing. I think a lot of the things that are happening in your life right now from outside of your own circle should be a reminder to you that people want you here living and breathing.
I'm loving it.
And they want Ricky... You know, the guy that everybody knows, the one with no off switch, all of that. Sometimes you have to put that off switch at least halfway.
You gotta, you
and
gotta
I think
create.
You need to try to learn how to do that.
And use it.
Yeah.
Don't put an off switch there and never turn the light off. You know?
Exactly.
And I can tell you, by the doctors, and by the way I feel, I use that switch.
Okay, good.
I make warning to anyone, and I think younger people aren't doing drugs as much, and I think at the same time and the rate, they're doing it more.
Right.
Alcohol is there.
Well, the reason why this is important to Ricky is because of the stuff he's had to deal with here lately, the health issues within the last year or two that he's dealt with. But I'm proud of you because you're finally speaking out. You're a very private guy, and I know that. And you deal with all of your own you know, your own skeletons in your own way, and that's okay. But once you're sitting in front of a camera and you're willing to share your story with other people, that becomes a whole different level of courage, in my opinion.
Well, thank you.
So first of all, I respect you for that, and you know how I feel about that. But second of all, you're here because you're wanting to spread a message out there.
Yes.
And that's where we're at in this part of the show. You're working with a lady out of Hughes Springs, is that right? Right? Tell us a little bit more about what you guys are working on.
This is fascinating, Boston, because when I got out of the hospital, my best friend, Bobby Ashmore, he was at a crossroads in his life with his wife, Madonna, who had helped me for years. They knew my demons. They even had the broom to help them sweep them under the rug while I'm blind to their face.
Mm-hmm.
They were good to me. But they were also moving south and would let me live there for years. All of a sudden, a day before they're moving, I get a phone call from a person that says, we'd like to meet you.
Yeah, so we're talking with Ricky, and you're going to tell us about what you're working on.
You know, Boston, when I did get out of the hospital the first time, you know, I had the opportunity to meet someone who had been a Ricky Lynn and a Ricky Gregg and a Ricky Lynn Gregg fan.
So from way back?
From 1973.
Yeah.
And
wow.
And I say that because we're foggy on these early years, but we're up to date with the 90s and the late 80s. She came out, and we forged a friendship that a higher being was never going to let us be apart. And she happens to have a foundation called TD Cares and Tammy's Homes. And they facilitate and help man or woman who may be a drug addict or an alcoholic. She has homes from Dallas to our area that that she gives aid, finances. There's one girl in particular at 17 that was a drug addict here in Longview, and I say here in Longview, here in the East Texas area. She took in for a month. She left. She came back. She's been there a year and a half now. TD Homes has paid for her college.
Wow.
She's now ministering, and I say ministering, she's going and giving testimony in prisons. And so that's what she's wanting to achieve is to, because she was someone of my sort. You know, we grew up in the same place.
So she's been there.
She's been there. And she had something traumatic happened in her life that on another show at another time, maybe when TD's on, that we can talk about that brought her closer to Jesus. And at the time that I came back alive, which I saw you the day after, I called myself a new creation. I wouldn't let anybody call me Ricky for a couple of days after they got everything back in sync.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm talking about the rhythm of my heart. I could have been like you told them, I could have been dead.
Mm-hmm.
And, and I really leaned on a crucifix and my Savior as I'd known him as a 5-year-old.
Mm-hmm.
Gone to him, but never watered that seed much. But gone to him, but, you know, took a long time for this tree to build. And she came into my life and introduced me to what she does. And she wants to make bigger her foundation to others out there that need this sort of thing, and she's poured in multi-dollars into making it happen. After she came into my life,
sounds like an angel,
an earth angel she is. And you know, we talk about vessels. You're sort of like a vessel.
Really?
Yes. And but we have these spiritual vessels. She's more like a river, and there's the vessels. She is truly a river.
You care about her?
I love her.
All right, so watch this. You ready?
Yeah.
Do you know your success is vital to her?
I wouldn't look at it that way, but
yeah, it's true though.
If you
fall, that doesn't help her at all, does it?
Not at all.
So you just told me you love her.
I certainly.
So there's another reason for you not to fail.
Absolutely, absolutely, and we're We got this thing.
Good.
It's funny, we can talk and not say a word. Mm-hmm. Immediately. She is going to have a concert series.
Uh-oh.
Beginning sometime next spring in Hugh Springs. And it's going to be jammed up. Her son builds 660 guitars, in case somebody wants to go on the website and see what they're all about. The graphite, aluminum. I've been playing one here lately. She's got a lot to offer to the musician of East Texas.
Good.
And she loves musicians. She loves the brokenhearted, so she can lift them. Mm-hmm. She loves the drug addict or battered women. She is really into helping battered women. And of course, that's something.
Does she have social media and stuff that people can check out?
She has social media and...
Do you happen to know what it is?
I don't.
Okay.
But...
Maybe we can find out, and we'll try to get that linked up in the description later.
You know, every dang note I took, I didn't take that, and she has something.
Well, you'll have to get her in contact with me so that I can put all that stuff on there.
As a matter of fact, I live on her her land now.
Very cool.
I took a job with her to be the spokesperson of TD Cares and Tammy Holmes.
And that's the name of it, TD Cares and Tammy Holmes.
Right, and each one has a different function. Battered women, children, they're homeless.
Right.
She'll find homes. Sister Linda runs a lot of these things for her, and she needs to have some attention, because Sister Linda is another earth angel, truly give up her entire life to help others.
Right.
Her entire life. And so that's what's happening right now in my life. I'm working for her.
Good.
And even though I go out and play with my compadres at Bodacious.
Mm-hmm. On Tuesday nights? On Tuesday nights,
yeah.
Shameless plug.
Right. I mean, people are going, why aren't you...
Bodacious and Kilgore.
Yeah, right. I asked my cousin one day, he's a drummer. I said, what's the talk about me, cuz? He goes, well, the talk is you play crappy places and take crummy money.
It's the story of East Texas,
yeah,
man.
And I'm thinking, well, you don't realize I get money, you know.
They pay him in tacos. I mean,
right. I don't. Money's something I don't worry about. And and then the incident happened with my heart, and then she has this incredible story. I mean, her story is so incredible, and it changed her life. But then again, it didn't change her. In a lot of ways, I said, you know, I don't have any bad habits. I cuss too much. Now, when I lived in Tennessee, I didn't cuss at all because nobody's cussing. Now, I mean, I'm a cuss machine.
We've gone almost an hour here, and you haven't said one. Super proud of you.
Whatever it was. Dumbacity, that's what it was.
Dumbacity. That's not a cuss word.
That's not a cuss word. No. That's a
not
fact.
In my world.
Yeah, amen.
Might be a new word.
Right.
Maybe it is a new cuss word. The Ricky Lynn Gregg Show. So, guys, we've been sitting here with Ricky Lynn Gregg. One of my favorite people on the planet. And I really hope that, you know, you can follow through, because a lot of people care about you, man. I know there's a lot of folks out there that care about you more than you care about you. And you need to keep your eyes on that.
I certainly will. And you know what? I know that if I begin to slip, you'll remind me.
Damn straight.
Because I want to.
He might change phone numbers, but I always find Ricky.
I lose phones all the time, y'all all know that. But I did just get out of the hospital to be here. And I had to blow off.
Raffle this off.
I had to blow off. I had to blow off Sunday where we were going to do it. And I was going... This is like the fifth time I've let him down.
And, he has never let me down.
And, you know, we were going to have a big kick at the award show. I think we were going to make up something. You know, we had an award to present.
Yeah, I've got it here somewhere.
And I had an award to receive.
I think it's blindfolded in the bathroom.
I want it to be here. I want it to be part of the trophy.
This is always next year.
Because I can get it.
It's always next year.
Hey, you know, I've been thinking about that. I was going, I got to work a little harder.
That's right.
Even start,
yeah.
Begin to think about approaches.
Absolutely. All right, guys. So you guys have been tuned into the ETX Rock Show episode number 205 with yours truly, Boss and Chris, with my brother from a different mother, Ricky Lynn Gregg. I love you, man.
I love you too, Boss.
You're a good man, and we're rooting for you, man.
Thank you.
Every day.
Thank you.
And we're going to do more with Ricky here in the future. You might just see us out on the town checking out new talent together here and there. That should be fun. I'll make sure he's drinking water. But if you tuned into the ETX Rock Show for the first time, what is wrong with you, first of all? We've been working our butts off. We definitely appreciate your first time tuning in. If you want to know where you can follow along with us, it's very simple. We are at ETX Rocks everywhere, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter. Follow along with everything we're doing. Wherever you're listening or watching at, please hit the subscribe, follow, or like buttons. That definitely helps us a lot when you follow and all that stuff out there. So if you want to support us even more, you can donate $1 or $1 million. We will not take more than $1 million. But you can do that to www.paypal.me/ETX Rocks. And eventually we'll get up out of here and out of the living room. That's the plan. Maybe a studio apartment. Not really. But yeah, $1 to $1 million, $1 million and $1 is too much. I can't handle the tax rate on that. So keep it under $1 million if you don't mind. As we always say on this show, I want to thank you guys out there for always supporting live music of all genres and all styles. And don't you ever forget.
ETX Rocks.
That's right.
Howdy folks, this is Aaron Watson.
This is Bree Bagwell.
This is Jake.
And this is Walter from Rocky Queen.
This is Curtis Grimes.
Monty Pittman.
This is Doug Supernon.
I'm Heather Little.
This is Rob Redwine.
Ho! Hey folks, I'm WWE Hall of Famer Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
Hey guys, I'm Katie Lynn, and make sure to tune in to ETX Rocks with
Boston Chris.
Hello, y'all. This is Ronnie Millsap, and thanks for tuning in to the ETX Rocks show.
Tough guy! Ho!
Hey guys, we're Blacktop Mojo, and thank you for tuning in to ETX Rocks.